Still awake. I know it's the conference is about to end, and people are maybe tired after a very good conference. But I hope I can give you something to take with you home. I'm gonna do a case study on a project that we recently did, and the project consists of a lot of different things. And I'm gonna focus on one thing. Sorry, but I have to. I'm going to focus on one thing on the website, and that's relating content across a pretty defined structure. So that's going to be the main focus. But I'll talk a little bit about different things in this project that we did. Unfortunately, I have no changes, so I'll have to use this. It'll work. My name is Jan Erik. I'm the founder and CTO of Mock, which is a Copenhagen-based company. We do Type 3, and I've been doing Type 3 since 2005, and I've been doing it a few years before that. We work only with Type 3, and we have a lot of different customers, large and small. And this is one of the cases that I'm going to present. When I'm not working at Mock, I'm spending time with my family. I'm pretty active and very interested in sports, so these are my three kids. This is my last trip to Germany, which was Berlin a few weeks ago, in the Berlin Marathon. And the last part is I'm also part of the competition swimmer team in Denmark. So a master team. As you can see, it's a boys and girls team. Enough with the embarrassing pictures. Let's talk about the case here. It's a website for the Ministry of Food, Agriculture and Fisheries of Denmark. I always have a hard time saying that. I think the English version of it is a very long. It's a four-year project that we won. It was a public tender that we won about 9 months ago. And it's a four-year plan to convert a lot of websites to Type 3, including intranets. The main website is fvm.dk, as you can see here, but it actually consists of a lot of more websites, and during the next 3.5 years, we will slowly convert all of the sub-departments' websites to Type 3. At least that is the plan. Some of you were maybe attending Rasmus's closing talk yesterday and saw this video with Benjamin from the Ministry of Food, Agriculture and Fisheries talking about their choice of Type 3. I'm not going to show you the video, you can probably find it in Rasmus's talk. But what we really like about it is that they are actively supporting Type 3. They are standing out publicly saying, we chose Type 3 for these and these reasons. They are dedicated to making sure that Type 3 is being maintained, and they are part of our Type 3 client follow group that Rasmus is leading. And they are also taking a look at NIAS and Flow, of course. But when we were pitching this, we took a decision that their side was not yet ready for NIAS. And I think that still holds. But they're actively looking at it, making a judgment, when will this be ready for our type of site. Let me just show you the site. It looks like this. It's a pretty traditional site. Most of the ministry websites in Denmark are pretty boring. They are not front runners of design and visual identity. They're pretty traditional, and this goes for this site as well. Looks like this. I'll show you more a little bit later. Let me just step back a little bit and talk about enterprise CMS demands. We talk a lot about different CMSs and how is Type 3 different from other content management systems. And one part that we like and others like to say is that Type 3 is really an enterprise CMS. But what is an enterprise CMS? What features makes a content management system enterprise ready or enabled or whatever word people are using? For this particular installation, these are the things that were important to them, and that is something that we typically see when clients are asking for enterprise content management system. They need multi-site installations. We have two type of three installations, one for intranets and one for all the internet. So they want all the sites in one type of three installation. So we need to support that. Type of three has been doing that for forever. They have a lot of editors. They have a lot of different kinds of editors. Some editors are editing content every day working with the system. Some editors are not working every day with the system. Perhaps they're only creating news, maintaining calendars, just once in a while reviewing content or changing images. And they don't use the system very often, and they need to have a different access role than the editor that works with Type of 3 every day. And Type of 3 supports that, and also in multi-site configurations, so editors will only see what they are allowed to. It's a responsive design. As Sven said in his last talk, this has really not anything to do with the content management system, but our clients are still asking, can Type of 3 do responsive web design? And yes, the answer is yes, we can do responsive web design with Type of 3, as can probably all other content management systems. But it's often a requirement. One big part of this project was accessibility. And with accessibility, I mean WCAG 2.0 AA compliance. So we have some standards that we have to live up to. And this is really important for this ministry and in general for all public websites, governmental websites of in Denmark. We defined a few key indicators or success criteria for this project, and this was one of them. They wanted to rank high in all accessibility studies, and they wanted to make sure that when Danish media once in a while goes out and checks public websites for accessibility issues, they do not want to be mentioned, or they want to be mentioned, but as a good example. And they actually were, so it was very important, and it required actually a lot of work. Another part that we often see when people ask for enterprise assistance, but actually on almost all sites, is good and fast search. And so this is also part of this system. There's some tweaks to this that I'll show a little bit later. Another part, and that's actually what I'm going to spend most of the talk on, is taxonomy or tagging content, relating content across different side trees and having a nonlinear flow through your website, so you don't have to navigate through a tree structure all the time. And this is something we see more and more often, and people are often asking, can Type of 3 do this, and why is Type of 3 not as good as Drupal or Joomla or whatever system of the day that they are looking at? Why is Type of 3 not able to do this? And I'll show that it can be done with Type of 3 and it works. And of course, performance is always an issue, and also for public websites, there's a lot to say about performance, and I'm not going to say too much about it today. We're solving the front-end performance part with Varnish and doing some stuff with responsive images and so on. And the back-end performance is something that we are still struggling on making the Type of 3 back-end perform with many editors. But that's ongoing progress. So one thing on this side is that it's a multi-site installation. It currently consists of about 8 sites. I know this is very small, but it has one primary site, which is fvm.dk. And some of you might have noticed there was one important part missing in the last slide, and that was translation. And that's because they actually decided on this project to have separate sites for separate languages. Usually when we look up or talk about enterprise features of content management, localization always comes up. And Type of 3 is luckily very good at this. In this project it was not an issue because they decided already that they wanted separate sites for separate languages with separate domains and everything. So that was not really a concern in this setup. So it consists of a Danish site, it consists of an English version of the Danish sites, it consists of a few small campaign sites, and then the big departments are starting now to being converted to Type 3. The main site is only about 700 pages. The first department, which is called the Danish Agri-Fish Agency in English, is being converted now, and that's about 7,000 pages. And so we are ending up with an installation of, in the end, about 30 installations with a total of maybe 50, 60,000 pages. So it's a rather big installation with a lot of sites in it. One important part of this is the different sites will, some sites will look like this. This is the framework site. This is the first site that we made for this installation. And it's actually more than just a site. It's really sort of a framework for being able to easily kickstart new site or sub-sites. So one part of it is that some sites will have completely different design. We'll look, we won't be able to see that it's the same base framework solution, but a lot of them will actually need to look the same, just being themed differently. So what we did was to create an easy system where with TypeScript constants, you can change, I think there are 8 key colors that you can change. And with that, you can make your site look like this. This is the Danish Agri-Fish Agency site, which is also part of this, and it looks exactly like the other site, except that all the colors are changed. And this is, can be done by the editors themselves. They can kickstart new sites, and they can change all colors themselves. And that is actually important for many reasons. One of the reasons is that they're tweaking the colors a lot due to accessibility concerns. We need to make sure that the color contrast on all combinations are working. So so links on white background should have color contrast on the different shades. In this case, the blue shades. Everything should be compliant with accessibility demands. So that's one thing that they use a lot when they create theming sites. Everything is done with pure CSS, so the TypeScript is simply generating extra CSS that is pulled to this installation. So that has one thing. I'm not there's not going to be much code in this talk, but I have to show a little bit of it anyway. This is a menu on the normal side, and it consists of a very pretty traditional menu with a mouse over effect. And it has a small icon, and of course this icon needs to be changed as well. And we don't want our editors to upload 25 different icons to have different colors and test with that and open Photoshop and change the color. So what we did, which is I guess pretty normal in new websites today, is to not use images but instead use a custom generated typeface made for this. So this particular thing, and again I apologize for actually showing you code, but I think I have to in this case, it's just a normal list with an anchor tag, and then everything is done with CSS. So we use CSS3 selectors for having content after, and then we style it with a certain font, and then we have this thing. So now we can, with CSS, simply change the color of this icon. And we use that everywhere for all icons on the site, and that also has the very neat feature that it loads a lot faster. Of course, the font needs to load, but that's only one time, and then all the icons are there, and we can change the colors, and we can rotate them, so we don't need this arrow in 4 directions. We only need one, and we can transform it with CSS if we want to. So it has a lot of upsides working with HTML5 and CSS3, also for accessibility concerns. We talked about editors, and they have a lot of editors in this system. We decided on making a rather complex structure. So we have a backend, you have a lot of backend user groups, you have one for each site, and then we have something we call roles, but everything is really done using built-in Type 3 access roles. So we have a very versatile system of access. We have currently 98 editors using the system, and it will expand to at least 300 editors, and everything is, there's no custom-made access control or anything. Everything works out of the box with Tyro 3 nested backend user groups. So that's very neat, and it was also one of the key selling points when we did this pitch, that we were able to, out of the box, support many different roles and very fine-grained access controls to the system. Then there's a responsive part. Since it was part of the title of the talk, I think I'd better at least show a little bit of it, but I'm not going to go very deep into this. It's not too normal for Danish governmental sites to actually be responsive, but of course, as everyone else, they're starting to have more and more focus on their visitors visiting the website with mobile devices. And especially one group that uses the site a lot is the press, and they are typically viewing content, especially news and press releases, on mobile devices. So it was a requirement, and it should be, I think, to of course have a site that's fully responsive on all devices. Of course, we had to decide, especially what devices to do this on. So don't take your very old Android phone and go and view the site, but it should work in most modern mobile and mobile devices. The accessibility parts, although it was a very big part of this project and one of the key success criteria, I'm not going to talk that much about it. And except that they had a very strong focus on it. They actually hired an external agency, Siteimproof. It's a London-based company, also working in Denmark, and I think also in Germany, to do a review of the site and making a report on how compliant is this site compared to other sites. And there were some small issues that were fixed, but in general, the site is following the WCAG 2.0 AA standard. So people with disabilities can still watch the site. That's a lot of work into actually making the site fully accessible. And it's also work in progress because a lot of the work has to be done by the editors. They have to make sure that every images have correct description. There's a lot of every tables needs to be correctly marked up. There's a lot of work in the content part of this. And of course, we actually took a look at the government package of Tyro 3, which and took a lot of the concepts from there. And so that was very nice to have at least a starting point to do this. Again, a little bit technical details. A lot of, if you open the source code in the site, you will see a lot of HTML5 and ARIA makeup to make this accessible. We're trying to follow all the standards as best possible, so we have a lot of definition for how things should show. Just this small close button will be read with the correct close search bar button if you use a screen reader to actually view the site. Tab order is important, so you can tap through the site in the correct order and jump to content, stuff like that. Enough about that. Another very important part of this, which was also part of the decision process, was that they needed to be able to send out news instantly. They used the news system for press releases, and so they need a lot of people to sign up for press releases, and they need to send them out right now, not in 5 minutes, but just right now when the press release is released. So we took a look at different extensions for that and ended up deciding that there was no one supporting our need, our demand. So we ended up creating one ourselves, which is has an optional integration with external email providers. In our case, it's Mandrill, which is MailChimp's mail engine. So we can send out tens of thousands of emails in very, very, very short time. So we will release this as an extension very, very soon. Again, it's not something I'll dig into. There's a lot of things on this side. Search is something that we see a lot, and this I will dig a little bit more into later. Multi-site search. We have a lot of sites in Tyro 3. We need to search in all of them. Some of them needs to have results mixed. Some of them needs to have their own search site, but we also need a global search solution. And one part about this is that we want it fast, of course. we wanted coupled with our internal, we have a lot of meta tags, especially on taxonomy. We have tags and we have content types, which I'll show you in a minute. And we want that to be searchable as well. And I'll show you that in a minute. And one very important part of this, which we could not do out of the box, was that a lot of sites are not being converted yet. We are converting them in the next 3.5 years. So we need a mechanism to make them searchable until they are ported to Title III. So what we're actually doing is we're doing an external crawling of non-Title III sites and injecting that into a Solr index and using a Title III Solr extension for searching. I'll show you that in a minute. It's actually a very neat feature. So the main focus of this talk is on relating content across boundaries or structured content boundaries. And I'm going to talk a little bit about structured versus unstructured content and what do I mean by that. Type 3 typically has a very strong focus on structured content. It has a page tree, which is very central part of Type 3. Many years ago, when we had talked about what are the central parts of Type 3, when we were discussing whether to rebase to refactor Type 3 or create a new one, so this is like 7-8 years ago. And we had a lot of discussions, what are the central parts of Type 3? TypeScript was one that was mentioned, but the page tree was also mentioned as a key part of Type 3. So I think that's really very central to Type 3 to have a page structure and have a hierarchical structure in pages. And in my world, this is very something that I just take for granted, that Type 3 and all content management systems work in that way, but they do not. There's a lot of other CMSs that do not have a page tree and do not work with structured content in that way. So, but maybe it doesn't have to be that way. Maybe Type 3 can do things differently. A little bit about structured content. What do I mean by structured content? This is an example from one of the sites that we are going to convert to this Type 3 installation now, not on this design, fortunately. And you can see here that we are very deep in the structure. We are at I don't know, 6-7 levels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 levels of content. We have a traditional left menu with where we can see where in the site we are. Just to illustrate that, this is part of the page tree on just that single page I'm showing. So this is a huge page tree with lots of levels. We have 7 or 8 levels of content, and it's really a big site. You can imagine 7,000 pages all structured like this. And the thing is, the Type 3 is really, really good at this. The page tree makes it very easy to find content and to edit exactly the page that you want. If you have a traditional website navigation like the one we just saw, you will probably very easily find the page that you are looking to edit in the backend with this page tree. So that's very good, and that's probably why Type 3 is often, at least in Denmark, chosen for projects with a more traditional structured content approach. So unstructured content, what do I mean by unstructured content? I think I have to explain that. One of the best examples are news sites, and for some reason Drupal is very strong on news sites in Denmark. It's not for some reason, it's actually because of this. This is an example of a Danish news site. All articles are always tagged with certain subjects. We have no left navigation of structured content. All articles are either selected by date, which is very typical for news sites, of course, but also on categories. So if I'm interested in IT work labor, I can see that this article is tagged with that, and based on that tag, I can find automatically, the system will find other related content based on this taxonomy or these tags that are associated with this. And this is often seen in most news sites. This is another example, also a Danish newspaper, where you can see a lot of the articles are somehow related. And this is typically not editors saying this article is related to this article and this one. This is typically tag-based or in some versions, so you can automatically relate content to to make a site that has a nonlinear flow in content. Just some more examples. You can see that everything is pulled out on something either by tags or by date. So what about unstructured content in Type 3? Can it be done? Is it a good idea? And we've done a few sites where people came to us and say, we want Type 3, we want you to do it. We want a site that's completely unstructured. Everything should be taggable. We should find news records and articles and different stuff only based on tags. What we a few times experienced is that once we delivered the site, they self-decide, oh, but how do I make a menu? Now I cannot get my users to find this particular article that I'm interested in, so I want a left navigation anyway to sort of guide them to that. And that's a very key point in this, that building a taxonomy-based content strategy is not necessarily a technical challenge. There are some technical challenges, but that can be overcome. But it's very, very much an editorial challenge. You need to make your editors trust your taxonomy, trust that you can find content across, and you need to work a lot with defining your different taxonomy terms. So everything is really about control and trust your taxonomy. I'm going to show you some examples of how we did it on this this side. So one of the criteria for this pitch was to be able to do tag-based content. We need a structure. The site is actually very structured there with these six or seven layers, and everything is put into subpages. So it fits very well into a Type 3 world. But the information architect agency that were hired to actually do the information architecture and the final design are coming from a very Drupal-centric world, and they were dreaming up a lot of things about tagging content. So we sort of had to pitch in with a solution that could compete with Drupal and Sitecore to make a site that also has tags and can relate content across a very structured page tree. So this is actually not one or the other. This is a solution that that encompasses both structured and unstructured content. A little bit about taxonomies. There's some different words that I use through this presentation. And one thing is a vocabulary. Vocabulary is simply a selection or a subset of tags or terms that I use. And the collection of terms, which can be structured in some ways, or a term can have subterms, is performs a or consists of vocabulary. And you can build this up, and you can have several vocabularies for one site or for one installation. In this installation, this particular installation, they have three vocabularies or three dimensions in their taxonomy. It's a content type, which is really a one-to-one relation. You can only select one content type. A page or news or a recipe or something can only be one thing. That's not a technical thing, it's something we decided that it's easier to understand. And then we have two more free dimensions of vocabularies, which are target groups. So what target group is this article or news item or recipe or whatever it is that we are tagging? To whom is it concerned? And the other one is a keyword. What keywords do we assign to this thing? They decided very wisely, I think, to have it centrally managed. So there are editors which are in charge of maintaining the taxonomy, making sure it's the right words they use. So the editors themselves cannot add to the taxonomy. They have this centrally controlled. They have one taxonomy for each site, but there's also a possibility to have mix in global taxonomies which will work across the different sites, which has some very neat features when you're searching, doing global search. And it's fully integrated with our Solr search, which I'll show you. A lot of screenshots. I'm going to go through them pretty fast, and you can look at them afterwards. We maintain vocabularies inside of pages in different folders of Type 3. So this is an example of the keywords vocabulary for the FVM DK English sites. And everything is based on Type 3 sys category settings. So those of you, this has a six Type 3 CMS 6 feature, which we are using to do this. When I'm editing something, it could be a page, could be a news, could be whatever it is that we decide are part of this taxonomy. We add one content type, we add one target group, it could be press, and then we add some categories to this, and we use the built-in tools for assigning all of this, so you can sort of build a taxonomy, you can search it, and you can easily find the text that you want to assign to your record or item. So structure and vocabulary is like this. This is an example of agricultural science, which is a term or a tag, and it's a sub-term of agriculture. So we have so when we decide we want to show everything that's about agriculture, we also find things that are tagged with agricultural sciences. So showing content in the front end, one thing is assigning everything, but we also need to show this in the front end. And here's an example of an article. This is a news article in this case, but it could just as well be a page or something different. We show, in this case, only the keywords. Not all of the sites use all three dimensions. This site does not use the target group dimension, so it's not displayed here. So we can see that this is tagged with inspections, food, and with meat inspections. And at the bottom of the news news page, we can see that we always relate content based on these tags. So we have a lot of other content that are tagged with this, and they are always sorted by relevance. And by relevance, I mean we always find the items that have most keywords in that are most similar based on the number of keywords they have in common. So this makes it very easy to sort of navigate through the site and find things that are related to this. We also have some plugins for saying now I want on some theme page that's about organic food or whatever it is that they want to have. You have plugins where you can say, okay, I want all news items or all speeches or all content pages that are tagged with this and this keyword and are for this target group. So I want all news items that has target group press and are about organic food or something like that. And then it will on the front end, it will list all the things that match these criteria, which makes it very easy to make dynamic pages without actually having to do anything except tag your content. There's another feature which is in progress, doing tag clouds, so taking one page, traversing all sub-pages, collecting all the keywords we use and showing the most used keywords. So we have sort of a way to show the user what is the most used keyword on this page and all sub-pages. This works very well. For the editors, they're pretty good at actually using that taxonomy, so we get good results. And I encourage you to go and take a look at the site to see how it works. One part of this is integrating this with search, and I think this is where it really starts to get really interesting. We use Apache Solr for searching, which is very nice, and we are very happy with the Type 3x Solr extension. It works very well for us. And we couple that with the sys category things of Type 3.6, and we had to do some tweaks that are actually now part of 6.2 because we have three relations to categories. We have for each one for each of the different vocabularies, the content type, the target group, and the keywords. So what does this mean? Here's an example, and I actually wanted to create a video, but I think maybe I'll show you afterwards how it works. I'm doing a search, in this case, for organic. And when I do that, this is my result. I'm seeing six results. Now I'm doing the search on the English side, so you understand it, and that it's a lot smaller side. But you get the idea. Usually that would be a lot more results on organic. And on the right, I see that I can limit my search to different target groups or different content types. And what you can see below is I can also limit it to different. To different keywords. Yeah. So I decide, okay, I only want to see content pages. I'm not interested in news. I want to see real articles about this. So I limit my search to content page, and now I'm down to 3 results. And for all of the results, I can see the different keywords that's assigned to this. I can't see the target group because they're not using it on this site, but otherwise I would also be able to see that this is only for press or whoever it's targeted for. And with the built-in features of XSolr, I can simply narrow my search and use this faceted search to limit my search results. And now we can see I said I'm only interested in organic agriculture, and I get only articles that are tagged with this. So that makes it very easy to drill down your results on large searches, especially when there's 6, 7, 8, maybe 15,000 pages. It makes it easy for the user to actually find relevant content. I also said that we are indexing external sites, so we have quite a few sites that are going to be converted to this platform during the next 3.5 years. We also need them to be part of this search solution. So what we're doing is we are actually crawling external sites which are not built with Type 3. They're actually built with Microsoft CMS and one with, I can't remember, Sitecore, I think. We are indexing these sites, putting them into the SolR index, and then searching them with the Type 3 SolR extension. So this is an example of another site, non-Type 3 site, where we did the same search for organic, and we can see 90 results now with organic food from Denmark, and all of this links to this external non-Type 3 site. Now the problem is on that site, we do not know anything about possible taxonomies. It's different sites. They use a complete different vocabulary. So we cannot use the same faceted search or narrowing that we did before. But on this particular site, they actually use the keyword, the HTML meta keyword tag to very extensible, so we can extract that and then we can do faceted search and say, okay, I'm only interested in the ones with handles outtailer, which in this case, and I will limit my search to that. But all of the built-in features of the SolR extension. We're using an open source tool called Notch to do this. If anyone is interested, it works pretty well. That was a fast demo of how this works. I'm just gonna end this by trying to recap the key points of taxonomies in Type 3. And the one thing I want you to take home with you from this talk is that Type 3 is maybe the right or at least a tool for tag-based content. We can do a combination of structured and unstructured content. And one part you need to really, really take with you home and talk with your clients about, or if you are actually thinking about creating a site like this, is that you need to trust your taxonomy to make this work. You need to really trust the system. If it doesn't find the results that you expect, maybe it's because the taxonomy is wrong. You have to work with this and you have to figure out which words are my users searching for, which terms is relevant to my users to make this content strategy work. And then I think it's really important to have this integration with the whole search part. Actually, the project started out with an external company doing the search, so we had no search in this solution. But but when we were able to show them what we could really do, integrating things tightly with Type 3 and with the metadata stored in Type 3, they were convinced that maybe we should do the central search instead and then crawl their sites instead of their sites crawling our sites and doing stuff. So I hope that gave you an overview, and actually I just want to end this by thanking you, and I really enjoyed the conference, and I hope you got something out of it, so thank you.